Well, thanks for joining us again, Alex.
Thanks, Blake.
So the students have been hearing a bit about Zimbardo's prison study and how the power of de-individuation is often seen as an explanation for aggressive behaviour and why people do really horrible things to each other. Now, you actually tried to revisit that study more recently with the BBC in a recreation, if we want to call it that.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you could sort of tell us a bit about how that went, and
yeah,
you know, some of the challenges,
that, yeah,
and
yeah,
the challenges, and what you yeah actually concluded from that recreation.
Yeah, yeah. So I think we were, there's a lot of coming at this from lots of different perspectives. I think, so Zimbardo did his study in the early 70s, and I think in that time, kind of theory in psychology has advanced quite a long way beyond some of the ideas that he presented. I think we now have a much more nuanced understanding, say, of de-individuation, so that actually de-individuation can drive negative things. It can actually drive positive behaviors too. We were concerned kind of with the core of Zimbardo's analysis arriving out of the Stanford prison experiment was the idea that when people are put in particular kinds of situations, they conform pretty much thoughtlessly or mindlessly to role. They just kind of do what seems to be required of them or expected of them. So his argument was, look, we brought in some participants, we dressed them up as guards, and they said, well, how am I meant to behave? Oh, look, I've got a guard's uniform. Being a guard involves brutalizing prisoners, so I better just get on with it. So you sort of conform naturally, mindlessly, thoughtlessly, effortlessly to the demands of the situation. And on the face of it, you know, there's a lot of people who sort of buy into that analysis, particularly if you are someone who is hurting other people. It's quite a useful analysis after the fact to say, oh, no, it wasn't really about me. It was just the situation. I got a bit carried away and I just sort of, you know, well, I had the uniform. And I just said, you know, so I wasn't really thinking. It wasn't really me. Well, actually, I think there's a lot of grounds for questioning that analysis. The most obvious one, I think, is if you go and look at footage of Zimbardo's study, and there's only limited footage available, what you see is that, contrary to his idea that the participants were not given any instruction, they just turned up and this sort of happened, what you see is that he gave his guards very particular briefing, he instructed them, he gave them a sort of template for behaving in particular ways. He said, what we're going to do is we're going to take away the prisoner's individuality in various ways, we're going to make them feel powerless, and so on. So he very clearly had a kind of a plan, and he exposed his guards to the plan. And I think really the study then is much less about mindless conformity and much more about what we call engaged followership. So the participants who'd come along to take part in Zimbardo's study, identified with him and his project, they said, what can we do for this project? What's our role? And he told them what was basically they were looking for. And to the extent that they identified with him and that mission, they got on with it. But actually, again, what you see is some did and some didn't. I mean, so actually, and you see this in other kinds of settings, you know, where groups engage in acts of brutality. Yeah, some people are pretty enthusiastic about that, but other people withdraw completely from it. So the idea you haven't got any choice, you just bound up and you must inevitably conform is frankly nonsense. Okay, so what is going on, we argue, and actually it's similar to the point we made in relation to the Milgram studies that we talked about earlier, is that actually the key process here is one of identification. If you identify with the leadership, if you identify with the mission, then you engage with the tasks that you have, and you do so perhaps enthusiastically and creatively. You don't actually conform. Actually, you're much more sort of like, what do I do? Follow orders. No, you say, what is it that I'm being looked for? And so you go beyond kind of those kinds of expectations. So you're an enthusiastic, engaged participant. And that's indeed what you see in kind of real world settings. If you look at something like Abu Ghraib in Iraq, firstly, you see that variability. It wasn't the case that everybody brutalized the prisoners, very far from it. Some people did, but some people didn't want anything to do with it. But also those people who did identified with a particular model of leadership and what they thought they were meant to be doing there. And more particularly, they were very clear about what they were doing. They were not thoughtless or blind or mindless. No, they were happy about what they were doing. If you remember, the pictures that come out of that are of the soldiers with their thumbs up, smiling at the camera, pleased with what they'd done because they thought they'd done something great for a great cause. Of course, we, from a different perspective, see things very differently.
it's interesting if you look at the video that there is of the Zimbardo study, like he actually seems to do a lot to build that sense of identity. Like he's got them in these small meetings where they're all in a small space together and he's sort of, you know, talking about the sorts of things that they need to do to the prisoners.
Yeah, no, I think that's right. I think actually an interesting insight by one of my colleagues who's looked at a lot of that material is that if you really think about the function of that guard's briefing, it was much closer to a researcher briefing his research assistants. And I think actually the way that Zimbardo had set that study up was the guards were his research assistants, and they were really interested in the effects of what they did on the prisoners. What, you know, what was the effects of these various things? As it turned out, the focus of attention became on the guards, and Zimbardo very conveniently withdrew himself from the analysis of what was going on. A little kind of snippet is, if ever you see the film, the recent film of the Stanford prison experiment was released just last year, you'll see that that guard's briefing is completely missing, and the idea that there was a relationship between Zimbardo and his guards is completely absent. But I would argue you can't make sense of what went on there without paying attention to that. But again, it's something that we as psychologists often kind of airbrush out of our analyses. We imagine it's all just going on in people's head. But no, these are dynamic, group-based processes of influence, and they often center around leadership and followership. And that's a very powerful lens, I think, for reinterpreting these kinds of effects.
So if you sort of, ignore the role of the leader, of Zimbardo in the experiment, then you can, arrive at that conclusion that it's really about the roles, and then that was actually used as to excuse or explain the behaviour in Iraq by the American prison guards.
Yeah, so I think in many ways, people have made the point that his analysis is really an exercise in excusiology rather than psychology. And the other critical point side to this is, okay, so that's the analysis of what went on in Zimbardo. So we did our own study in which we revisited that paradigm, but unlike Zimbardo, we didn't play the role of leaders who told the guards what to do. We actually just followed the Zimbardo script, as it were, and said, well, just get on with it. And if in the absence of any leadership, people don't, if I were just to put you and a few other people in a prison, you wouldn't just start abusing anybody who turned up. Okay, no, you would need a reason to do that. You would need to have it as part of some collective cause that you believe to be right. What we found in our study, towards the end of our study, was that indeed, some of the participants decided to form a new group of what they called new guards, and they did want to brutalize some of the participants, but that was only as a result of a dynamic where they had come to believe in the collective cause and they had had some leadership to mobilize themselves as a group. And to the extent that they identified with that cause, they were willing to follow through on it, but only then. So the idea that people just go out willy-nilly and just do stuff in groups to other groups because it seems to be required in some abstract, non-specific way, just doesn't stack up.
I think also, interestingly, in your recreation of the study, the prisoners actually engaged in a lot of social behaviours and banded together in a way that wasn't seen in the original.
Well, the other side to, I mean, this is, in many ways, Zimbardo's study is actually very kind of rich, but for all the reasons that he doesn't kind of pick up on. So there's lots of interesting stuff in there, but for whatever reason, he chose not to address that. But one of the points in his study is, again, he was interested to say, and the prisoners just conform to their role, they just become very passive. Well, actually, the reason the prisoners became passive in his study was, again, because of the way that they were managed by Zimbardo, and he told them there was no possibility of escape, so he made them feel very hopeless. He also destroyed their sense of collective identity by putting sort of people within their midst who he led them to believe had been sort of planted, so that they were quite suspicious, they were suspicious of each other, didn't trust each other. What you see in those kinds of environments, actually in prison and in prisons more generally, is often that groups of prisoners or subgroups will indeed come together, display some form of solidarity, and engage in acts of resistance. Resistance was a large part of what went on in the Stanford prison experiment. It's not part of Zimbardo's analysis, it was there. It was a very big part of our study, and actually what we found, there was high levels of prisoner resistance in which they, displayed these forms of solidarity, challenged the system, and actually made it very difficult to run the prison effectively. And the key point is that is much, much closer to the reality of prison life. There's lots of reports on prison life in Western countries. The idea that guards are just going around brutalizing the prisoners, It does happen. It happened in the Northern Territory recently, but that's pretty exceptional. Most of the time you see pretty active forms of prisoner resistance, and also that the prisoners have quite a lot of agency. So it's actually, that's the reality that you have to kind of engage with, is how to get the prisoners aligned with the interests of the prisoner rather than kind of subverting it or challenging it. Because actually without, in some way, the cooperation of prisoners, prisons are very, very difficult places to run.
And in some prisons, there are places where the guards just can't go.
Absolutely.
Because they're so organised.
Yeah, I mean, lots and lots of prisons in South America where that's true. Even though in the maze in Northern Ireland, there were in the H block, there were areas that were pretty much off limits to guards. So again, the idea that it's just inevitable that guards will brutalise prisoners, it just doesn't match the data as we know it.
And I think sort of maybe just to sort of finish up the conclusion really is probably, you know, when we see these sort of behaviours from people in these roles, it's probably not helpful to sort of think about it as de-individuation excusing what they do, but putting the focus on leaders to actually to actually set what are the acceptable behaviours.
Yeah, I mean, the de-individuation thing buys into the idea that this is sort of uncontrolled and uncontrollable, and that it's just automatic. And I think no, it's a much more cultivated process of identification, as I say, hinging on leadership and followership. I mean, the nice thing from the perspective of perpetrators about de-individuation is you can say, no, it's about loss of reason associated with being in a group, and I'm not to blame. And I think our analysis suggests that doesn't really wash.
Excellent. Thank you very much.